In the years that I've been at UCLA, and most recently as the department chair, I've been honored to work with many remarkable colleagues, really, truly phenomenal students, and distinguished alumni. One of the most satisfying aspects of my job as department chair has, in fact, been in connecting with alumni who have changed the world in important and unexpected ways. Today's keynote speaker is an excellent example. That's the one. The 2017 recipient of the Creative Scholarship Award from the Society for the Study of Psychiatry and Culture for his significant contributions to the field of cultural psychiatry, Dr. Robert Lemelson, is a cultural anthropologist, ethnographic and documentary filmmaker, and a philanthropist who currently holds positions as a research anthropologist at UCLA's Semmel Institute of Neuroscience and as an adjunct professor of anthropology in our department. In terms of his training, while he received a BA in anthropology and biology from Hampshire College and an MA from the Committee on Human Development from the University of Chicago, the most important piece of information for us all here today is that he is a fellow Bruin. That's right. He's one of ours. He earned his PhD in anthropology at UCLA. Having conducted psychological and visual anthropological research in Indonesia, on the islands of Bali and Java for the past 25 years, his work has appeared in numerous journals and books, including two influential edited volumes with Cambridge University Press, Understanding Trauma, Integrating Biological, Clinical, and Cultural Perspectives, and Re-envisioning Psychiatry. His newest book, Afflictions, Steps Toward a Visual Psychological Anthropology, published in 2017, is one of the first books to integrate psychological and medical anthropology with the methodologies of visual anthropology. As already mentioned, in addition to his publications, Dr. Lemelson is also a filmmaker. In 2007, Dr. Lemelson founded Elemental Productions, now a world-renowned ethnographic and documentary film production company, dedicated to producing films focusing on culture, psychology, and personal experience. In that capacity, he's produced and directed more than a dozen films on subjects including trauma and health, the sex trade, mental illness, kinship, ritual, and more. His films have won many prestigious awards, including the Cine Golden Eagle Award and the Nevada Film Festival Silver Screen Award, amongst many others. Linking his films to both more traditional scholarly publications and to new cutting-edge digital media forms, such as the recently published immersive multimedia interactive film guide for his film Shadows and Illuminations, Dr. Lemelson is helping us to creatively expand the ways that anthropological insights and findings are engaged with and taken up by various publics. While all of this on its own is extremely impressive, Dr. Lemelson's intellectual vision also extends to his many philanthropic ventures. He is, for instance, the founding president of the Foundation for Psychocultural Research, a research foundation that supports work integrating the social and neurosciences. He also acts as director for the Lemelson Foundation, a foundation started by his late father, Jerome Lemelson, to support inventors, invention, and innovation in the United States and the developing world. Dr. Lemelson has also funded a number of programs supporting undergraduate and graduate student research in anthropology through the Robert Lemelson Foundation, which is a foundation separate from the Lemelson Foundation. These include the Lemelson SPA Conference Fund, the Lemelson SPA Student Fellows Program administered by the Society for Psychological Anthropology, the Society for Visual Anthropology, and the Robert Lemelson Foundation Graduate Research Fellowship Program, and most dear to our hearts here, our prestigious Lemelson Honors Program. So, if you could all please help me give a warm and proud welcome to Dr. Robert Lemelson, our 2019 Department of Anthropology Commencement Speaker.
Well, thanks so much, Jason, and thank you to my colleagues and to my great honor students. And the rest of the graduates. It's really an honor to be here. I'd like to actually address my comments to the parents who seem to be somewhat overlooked, because without our parents, none of us would be here. And the question of what is the value of anthropological education? Well, I think we've already seen, and I'm not going to go into it, UCLA is one of the top places in the world to study anthropology. So, great. Anthropology extends beyond the academic world, and it has deep implications for changing the world in really significant ways. And I'd like to talk about two programs I've been involved with, one of which, well, I'll just describe them and we'll see which has been a success or failure. So about 10 years ago, I was involved in a program to address issues of water, health, agriculture, biodiversity in the developing world, basic human needs, bringing basic human needs, ideas, and technologies to the least developed countries. And one of the issues we were looking at was the accessibility of water, in particular water for schools in southern Africa. In parts of Mozambique and Angola, Botswana, children often have to walk 3, 5, even 10 miles a day just to get water, and this obviously impacts their ability to do schoolwork. So there was a Dutch engineer who had this, seems like a really quite remarkable idea, that why don't we attach a water pump to a roundabout, a merry-go-round play device in playgrounds, and so when the kids go and play every day, it'll pump water to a cistern above the school. Seems like a great idea. And so the USAID and a number of foundations got involved, and they funded 400 or 500 of these. Now they did this without real local consultation. They thought, such a great idea, how can it fail? And they didn't have local consultation, they didn't do the hydrology or geography necessary, and so when they went to install these play pumps, a few things happened, and they installed them in the course of a year, of 400 or 500 of them, and first thing is, the kids figured out really quickly that this pump was for work. And they did, and kids like to play in different ways, and they don't want to be like basically as mules going around and around for hours, because that's what it took, hours of pumping every day to get water to the top of the cistern. The local people very much preferred a simpler hand pump that could have been installed for a tenth of the price. And finally, because the hydrology wasn't considered, the water table is much deeper than they imagined. And so I'm sorry to say, after really millions of dollars, a lot of effort, a lot of goodwill, almost none of these pumps 10 years later are functioning. And so that points out the failure of an anthropological approach to development, which resulted in not just a waste of money, but these kids going back out and having to walk miles a day and not going to school. And so what are some of those principles? Well, one of the principles of anthropology is obviously holism, to look at multiple aspects of whatever the topic is under consideration and consider them in a deep, and in the second way, in a critical way, to critically examine your assumptions about what works and what doesn't work, what's relevant, contextually relevant. The third one, that's what are the contextual issues you need to understand in order to solve some sort of problem. And the fourth is to do it with compassion. Now, there's no doubt that the original creators of this roundabout play pump idea had a compassionate approach, but the other of holism and context and critical thinking was largely lacking. So that brings me to the second project I was involved with, where we tried to, okay, let's bring those anthropological principles to the fore. And so this was also a problem involving child development. It had to do with the high rates of neonatal mortality in Vietnam. And this is particularly for preterms, for infants who are born at 7 or 8 months. The extraordinarily high rate of mortality, because these kids are typically, when they're born in the provinces, there wasn't at that time, this is now a bit later, there's better medical facilities, but at that time there were very poor provincial hospitals, and they would often bring them to places like Hanoi General Hospital for treatment. At that point they were really very ill, and the mortality rate was about 80%. Now kids, preterms, die for very understandable and treatable causes. One of the reasons they die is infantile jaundice. As I'm sure many of us experience with our own children, I did with my son, he had infantile jaundice. What's the treatment? You put them under a certain spectrum of light. the bilirubin that's produced by the liver that can cause brain damage, can cause mental retardation, can cause cerebral palsy, that gets conjugated, doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, and the children get better. So what was happening in these Vietnamese hospitals, and this is related back to the play pump example, when I first went to Hanoi General Hospital, there was a large courtyard. And in the courtyard was medical equipment in the rain. And I asked the doctor, why are you storing the medical equipment in the rain? He said, well, that's medical equipment that was donated in a charitable sense by foreign NGOs. The government says we can't throw it out, so we just store it in the rain. And that's kind of a metaphor for this form of development. So what we did is we implemented a program where they using local principles, using context, using local knowledge, local resources, they took the fluorescent bulbs. Now the donated equipment had fluorescent bulbs, which cost about $400 a pop. In hospitals like at UCLA Medical Center, every 2 weeks they change these bulbs out. It was just much too expensive to change the bulbs out on this equipment. And so they would just toss the equipment and then use whatever they could. And sometimes it's putting the kids into sunlight itself to hope that would cure their jaundice. And so we worked with a local engineering startup who went into the hospitals, spoke with the nurses, spoke with the doctors, got the local knowledge, the local resource streams, changed the fluorescent bulbs out, replaced them with LED lights, which are $1 or $2 instead of $400 a pop, and they're either on or off, providing full spectrum light. They changed the switches out. They did local training with the nurses, and that was really effective. It brought the rates of infantile jaundice death down markedly. That was combined with other technologies, another reason that kids preterms die is their lungs are undeveloped. And now, again, at UCLA Medical, we have surfactant, which is a spray. It cures it almost immediately, and that's on patent. It's too expensive in a place like Vietnam. So they put kids on CPAP, the continuous positive air pressure systems. But these also had the same problem as the phototherapy units, in that it was about $400, $500 of medical waste each time you took a kid off it. You had tubes, you had masks. So that, again, the local engineers went back, they re-engineered the CPAP devices, they built local washing stations. So instead of having disposable medical waste, everything was washable. You could use the same tubes and masks for over a year. It brought the price point down by like 98%. And there were a number of other technologies in this, what we call the Breath of Life program. Result of it is anthropological principles brought the rates of mortality among these preterms from 80% down to 20%. And there are now over 100,000 kids who would not be alive in Vietnam as good citizens, as productive citizens, than there were 10 years ago. So without anthropology, those kids would not be around. So let's give applause for our field. So now I'd like to address the students. So you have these forms of knowledge, this holistic knowledge, contextual, critical knowledge, and most importantly, compassionate knowledge. Go out there and use that knowledge to change the world. I'm sure you will do that. Good luck, and thank you.